Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Morro Bay State Park. My name is Robin Hazard, and I'm a California State Park interpreter for California State Parks. Give me a thumbs up if you've seen this logo before. Lots of thumbs. That's good to see. California State Parks are pretty unique. And this is one of 280 California state parks. So give me a thumbs up if you live in California. A lot of Californians here. Yeah, so we're really lucky here in California because California state parks are super unique. They're very diverse. So we've got some in deserts. We've got some in the mountains. We've got some in forests. We've got some in valleys. We have some of their entire museums. And we also have some that are on the coast, just like where I'm at today at Morro Bay State Park. But I have an important question for you. And I want you to turn to the person next to you and think about this question. Who do you think owns California State Parks? Go ahead and discuss it with someone next to you. Who do you think owns California State Parks? All right, are you guys ready for the answer? I need your participation though, okay? So everybody stick your finger up in the air just like this. I'm pointing at yourself because California State Parks belong to us. They belong to the public. These are public parks that belong to the public. So that means it's our responsibility to play in them, to explore them, and to protect them. And you don't get to see that just anywhere in the world. So we're pretty lucky here in California to be able to have these really unique parks all around our state, again, 280 of them, that belong to us. So this is one of your California state parks, Morro Bay State Park. And I'm just gonna do a little bit of orientation. So maybe you've been here before. Give me a thumbs up if you've been to Morro Bay. For those of you who have not been to Morro Bay, you may see that I have a significant feature just right here. And go ahead and discuss amongst the group you're with or maybe the person next to you on what you think this is. Now it looks pretty small, right? I could squish it between my fingers. It's pretty small. But in reality, it's not that small. It's actually really big. And by really big, I mean 581 feet tall big. This is a huge rock. Now, how on earth do you think this big rock got here? Pretty bizarre, right? How did this big rock get right here when it doesn't seem to have any big rocks around it? Maybe a meteor. Maybe it fell down a hill and rolled over here. If you thought volcano, you are correct. Because this used to be a volcano. We've got some cormorants flying. Keep in mind, you will probably see lots of wildlife behind me because this is a very popular spot for wildlife to live. So keep your eyes on the screen for anything that you might see fly by or swim by. We've got some low tide, so we might not see a whole lot of stuff swimming by, but we'll still be hopeful. So back to this volcano, it was a volcano 26 million years ago. And go ahead and think about what is inside a volcano. Some of you most likely learned this in school, especially if you're a fourth grader, maybe you've just graduated from fourth grade. What is inside this volcano? Lava, right? So 26 million years ago, we had a big volcano. It was much bigger than what you're seeing today. Much, much bigger. And inside there was lava. Now what happened to this particular volcano is we have our volcano, we have our lava inside, but what happened to this particular one is a little tiny air pocket formed. That little tiny air pocket formed and it actually cooled down the lava. It cooled it down so much, it solidified it and it turned it into a solid rock. And this is what's known as a volcanic plug. So you can kind of think of it as like the insides of a jelly donut. This is what's left over. So again, it was much, much bigger before, but over time, that soil, the vegetation and the plants that were on that volcano, on that mountain eroded away. And what we're left over is solid lava. Pretty cool, right? And again, it's really, really big. You can actually drive to this rock. You can walk around it. If we had some supersonic vision, you could see some little people walking around, a little tiny restroom, some cars. So this is a great spot to visit if you come to Morro Bay, and if you drive up the coast or down the coast of California, you'll most likely see this rock because you can see it from the highway. So again, this is a big significant feature here in Morro Bay. People have used it along the coastline, whether traveling by land or by water, as a navigational tool, letting them know exactly where they're at. And its name is Morro Rock. You can see over here, we have the town of Morro Bay. And then the water that you see behind me, again, it's low tide. So typically where I'm standing, I would be standing in the water, but it's low tide right now. This is the waters of Morro Bay. Now, if we scooch over here, you can actually see a strip of land. Now, this is a narrow strip of land. You can see some lighter patches right here, and that's actually sand. And you can see some darker patches. That's some plants and plant material. This is vegetation. Again, this is a really narrow strip of land. It has a funny name. It's called a sand spit. A sand spit. And it actually separates two bodies of water. So I've already told you this is the waters of Morro Bay. But what body of water do you think is on the other side? Go ahead and discuss it with the person next to you. What body of water do you think is on the other side of that sand spit? If you said the ocean, you get a brownie point. If you said the Pacific Ocean, you get 2 brownie points. Because for those of you that are in California, I am also in California. And the ocean that borders our state is the Pacific Ocean. And that's what we have right here. It's the Pacific Ocean on the other side. Now, give me a thumbs up if you've been to the Pacific Ocean, or maybe you've seen the Pacific Ocean. Lots of thumbs. Yeah. Especially this last winter, it can get pretty wild and crazy, right? We can get some big waves, lots of wind, can get high tides. So you never in general want to turn your back on the ocean like what I'm doing right now. But as you can see, it's super low tide and I can also see behind me. So it makes it safe. But in general, you never really want to turn your back on the ocean because it can get pretty wild and crazy. But this water right here, it looks pretty different, right? Would you say that maybe it's pretty calm? Pretty calm, right? If I'm a surfer, I most definitely do not want to come here because there are no waves. There are absolutely no waves. And it is so calm that you can actually see the reflection of Morro Rock in the water because the water is so still. And this calm water, we actually have the sand spit to thank for it because it helps to protect Morro Bay from that those wild winds, the big swell, and any weather that may be hitting the other side of the sand spit. And this water, this calm water, is absolutely ideal for wildlife. Wildlife love it here in Morro Bay, both on land or in the water. Both, all animals enjoy coming to Morro Bay. It's actually a very popular spot for mother animals. So Morro Bay is often known as a nursery because mother animals love to come here to raise their young. Some animals that you might be familiar with are sea otters. Sea otter mamas love to come here to raise their young pups. Pups are baby sea otters. They love to raise their young pups because the water's calm. There's a lot of food available to them and it's a protected space. They don't have to worry about fighting any big swell or waves. This is a wonderful spot for mother sea otters to raise their young. Another animal that you might be familiar with are leopard sharks. Leopard sharks love coming to Morro Bay to raise their young. The water's a little bit warmer. There's a lot of food available to them. And again, it's a safe spot to raise these young animals. So this again is often known as a nursery because it's a great spot for mother animals to raise their young. So we don't just have this protection here on the sand spit protecting Morro Bay. We have another level of protection and that's called a marine protected area. Can you guys say that with me? Marine protected area. Now it's a long bunch of words, but if we break it down, it makes it a little bit easier to understand what it is. So if I say the word marine, what do you think that means? The word marine, what does the word marine mean? Maybe ocean. So if I want to study marine science when I grew up, I want to study science of the ocean. If I want to talk about a marine animal, I'm talking about an animal that lives in the ocean. Now, what about the word protected? What does the word protected mean to you? To me, protected means safe. Safe. Now, what about the word area? What does the word area mean to you? Maybe a place or a space? Yeah, so if you break down those words, it makes it a little bit easier to understand. So again, a marine protected area is a place in the ocean that's safe. And it's safe for the animals that live there. So you can think about a marine protected area much like a park or maybe an underwater park. Raise your hand or give me a thumbs up if you've been to a park before. Now, this could be a California state park. This could be a national park. This could be a park down the street from your house. Parks are awesome, right? I love parks. Now, I work for a park, but even before I worked for parks, I still have parks because parks are so fun, right? We get to play in parks. We often get to see wildlife that we might not typically get to see just in our backyards or in our neighborhoods. And they're also outside. It's beautiful. We get to see plants. We get fresh air. We can move our bodies and exercise. So parks are a phenomenal thing. And for a long time, we never really had any parks in the ocean until about 10 years ago. So 10 years ago is when the MPA network along our coastline was created. So these MPAs, there's a lot of them in our state of California. We have 124. So all the way from the Mexican border, all the way up north to the northern border where we border Oregon, there are 124, and this makes the largest network of marine protected areas in the world. So we're really lucky here in California to have these beautiful coastlines, the water just off our coastlines protected. Now, not the entire water is protected, but we've got pockets, and they kind of serve as jumping off points for these animals. So again, these are protected places in the ocean. And again, it protects the animals that live in the ocean. So I'm going to share a little illustration with you guys. And while I'm sharing this illustration, I want you, one moment. So go ahead and look at that and see how it says MPAs are like underwater parks. We've got a dividing line in the middle. And on one side, it says MPA, which again is short for Marine Protected Area. And on the other side, we have an unprotected area. So go ahead and look at this for just a few moments. Maybe discuss with the people around you, what differences do you see from one side to the next? What differences do you see from one side to the next? So a couple things you may have noticed is that there's a lot more life on the MPA side, right? There's a lot more life. We've got a lot of different animals. We've got a lot going on. It just looks happier and healthier, right? So let's take a look at that. Let's look at the fish. You can see that there's a lot of fish. You can see that there's a lot of different kinds of fish. Now you can see the names of some of those fish. You can see a jack smelt, a barred surf perch, a red tail surf perch. Now, it's not important that you remember the names of these fish, but what's important to notice is that they're all different. This is what's known as diversity. And diversity is absolutely essential for a healthy ecosystem. So this is what's called biodiversity. In nature, we call this biodiversity, the diversity of life. So when you see that there's a lot of different species, a lot of different animals, a lot of different types of animals, this is already giving you a big clue that this is a healthier habitat. Now, what about that green stuff in the water? What do you think that green stuff is? You said seaweed or kelp, you're right. This is kelp, and when we have a lot of kelp, this is called a kelp forest. And you can see that this kelp forest is actually serving as a home or a shelter for these fish. You can see how they're tucked into that kelp forest. This is a place where they can rest. This is a place where they can eat. This is a place where they can raise their young. And this is a place where they can hide away from predators. So this is their shelter, just like the homes that you have, maybe the four walls and roof that you have over you. This is your shelter, right? This is where you rest. This is where you eat. This is where you hang out with your loved ones. This is where you feel safe. So this kelp forest is really important for these fish because this is where they live. Now, what about some other animals that we've got here? This one that I've just circled, what animal is that? If you said sea otter, you are right. And here in California, we have the southern sea otter. And this southern sea otter is also benefiting from this kelp forest. She's actually wrapped herself up in kelp. And why would she do that? Why would she wrap herself up in kelp? So she doesn't float away. She wraps herself up in kelp so she doesn't float away. And this way she can stay put and do all the busy things that she has to do in one day because she gets really busy. She has a lot of things to do. She has to eat 25% of her body weight every single day in order to survive. 25%. That's like maybe if you're a fourth grader, that's maybe like you eating 15 hamburgers every single day in order to survive. Now, that might sound like a good idea if you're hungry in the moment, but in reality, if you eat 15 hamburgers every single day, you're probably going to get sick and it's not going to make you a happy camper. But these sea otters, they need to eat that much food in order to survive. They also have to groom a lot. They have to groom for 2 to 4 hours every single day. 2 to 4 hours. Now tell me, do you brush your teeth and brush your hair for 2 to 4 hours every single day? Probably not, right? Because that's a long time. But these sea otters, they have to do that in order to survive. They have a lot of fur and they have to make sure they keep it nice and clean so that they can survive in this chilly ocean water. So having this kelp forest to tie themselves to, almost like a boat anchors itself in a marina, they can have their paws free and do all the busy things they need to do in a single day. Now let's move up and tell me these animals that I've just circled, what animals do you think they are? What do you think that animal is? It's definitely a kind of seabird. And if you've said pelican, you're right. These are pelicans, and these are brown pelicans. So if you've been along the coast and you've seen a pelican, go ahead and give me a thumbs up. And most likely the pelicans that you've seen are the brown pelicans. Now these brown pelicans are pretty cool. They have a really big wingspan. So from wingtip to wingtip, they stretch 6 feet long. So imagine an adult that you know that's 6 feet tall. That's pretty big, right? And these are the smallest of the pelican species in the world. We actually have another pelican that comes to Morro Bay known as the white pelican. And they're all white. They actually have a black underside on their wing and they can reach to 9 feet. So again, this brown pelican is 6 feet. And the white pelican is 9 feet. These are essentially baby dinosaurs, and they are really cool. So if we take a look, we can see this long beak here, and you can see this little tiny pouch right here. But pay attention to that pouch, because it's gonna look really different in a little bit. This is also what's known a gular pouch. Now these pelicans, again, they're very large, but they have a lot of really cool adaptations in order to survive in and around the ocean. So again, for those of you who have seen brown pelicans along the coast, or maybe in the future, you're gonna take a trip to the coast, I have a fun fact that you can share with the people that you're with. You'll notice that when these pelicans dive, they actually only dive to the left. They only dive to the left. Now, why on earth would that be? So these pelicans, they are actually doing this in order to protect themselves. So very quickly on yourself, very gently, I want you to touch the front of your throat, very gently. And you'll notice this is where your esophagus is, right? This is where your throat is. This is where food goes down to your belly. This is where your the water goes into your body. This is what enables us to talk. this is a very sensitive area, right? And when we dive into a pool of water, we're typically tucking our chins. We're tucking our chins so we don't belly flop right on our throat, because that would be extremely painful. Now, these pelicans, they actually have that esophagus, that sensitive area, running along the right side of their neck. And so in order to protect that right side of their neck, they tuck to the left when they dive, because they hit that water at 65 miles per hour, often from as high as 60 feet above the water. So they're hitting that water at a really, really high speed, using a lot of energy to do so. And so in order to protect themselves, they dive to the left. Now let's take a look again at that gular pouch. Remember that pouch just under the beak. Now hold on to your seats, because it's gonna look really different in just a second. Look how that pouch can expand. That pouch can expand to fit 3 gallons. So imagine a gallon of milk or water that you might have in your fridge right now. 3 of those can fit in that pelican pouch. That is amazing, right? Look how that thing expands. And that is so that they can get more fish for their buck. So remember, they're spending a lot of energy to dive into the water to get a snack. And so in order to get the most fish for their buck, they can expand that pouch. Again, this is an adaptation where that pouch can expand and they can get a lot of fish. So they're not spending a lot of energy to just get a handful of fish. They're spending a lot of energy and getting a good reward. So these pelicans, do they live in the ocean? No, they don't live in the ocean. But why do you think they'd benefit from being near a marine protected area? Why do you think they would benefit from being near a marine protected area? Because there's fish, right? Because there's fish. These pelicans are smart. They know where the food's at. So just like when you get hungry, it gets close to lunchtime, maybe you hang around the cafeteria or the kitchen or maybe your lunchbox, you're gonna go where the food's at. And these pelicans are the same way. They're gonna hang around where the food's at. So they're gonna hang around an MPA. And that's one really cool thing about seabirds is that they're a good indicator for the health of our oceans. So oftentimes when we're looking out at the ocean, often we just see the top, right? Maybe some waves, maybe some birds on the surface, maybe we can see something jumping out of the water. But unless we're snorkeling or scuba diving, we don't really see what's going on under the waves. But that's where seabirds can be a really good view into our ocean. We see a lot of seabirds, and if we see a lot of different kinds of seabirds, remember biodiversity, then that can be a really good indicator of the health of our oceans. That's letting us know, hey, there's probably a lot of food in there for them. So that's a really cool thing about seabirds when you see them along the coast. So let's take a look at our unprotected side. Some of you may have noticed that there's someone fishing, which is great. Raise your hand or give me a thumbs up if you enjoy fish, or maybe you enjoy other things that come from the ocean. Lots of us probably enjoy things that come from the ocean, even if you don't think that you do. So for those of us that brushed our teeth this morning, and no judgment if you haven't, because it's still early, but for those of you that brushed your teeth, a lot of toothpaste actually has a component in it that comes from kelp. And same with ice cream. Believe it or not, in a lot of ice creams, there is also kelp. It's a chemical component that you can also find within kelp. It's a form of algae, and it exists in our toothpaste oftentimes, as well as ice cream, and a lot of things that we typically eat, but also things like fish, of course, or maybe you're eating seaweed itself. Maybe you enjoy sushi and it's wrapped in seaweed. So a lot of things come from the ocean, and this is where we could get it from, so that's great. And maybe this individual is running a business or trying to feed their family. So this is wonderful. This is where we have the opportunity to do that. But if we look under the waves, you can see that there's no kelp forest. You can see that it's pretty different compared to our MPA side, right? Because just like a forest on land, you need a lot of trees in order to make a forest, right? One tree does not make a forest. And the same thing goes for our underwater forest. You need a lot of kelp in order to have a nice big kelp forest. You can also see that there's a couple fish in here. Again, not as many different kinds of fish. But you see that this fish right here is trying their hardest to hide behind that kelp, use that as shelter, maybe hide away from predators. And you can also see that we've got these right here, which we have not yet talked about. They look like little pin cushions. Sometimes they're red, sometimes they're purple. Does anybody know what those are? Talk about it with the folks around you. What animal is that spiky little thing on the bottom of the ocean floor? If you said sea urchin, you're right. Sea urchins. Now, what on earth do you think sea urchins eat? If you said algae or kelp, you're right. And that's actually a big reason why we don't have a big kelp forest here on the unprotected side. Because when you have these sea urchins in abundance, oftentimes they can mow down an entire kelp forest. And again, that is not great for the animals that rely on that kelp forest. A lot of animals, which we've already discussed, rely on that kelp forest. The fish, the sea otter, the pelicans, a lot of animals rely on that kelp forest. And when it's mowed down, that's a bad day for a lot of those animals. But we have a superhero in this picture. There is an animal that likes to eat sea urchins. Does anybody know what animal that is? What animal likes to eat sea urchins? Go ahead and discuss it with the folks around you. All right, you guys ready for the answer? Sea otters. Sea otters love to eat sea urchins. Remember, these sea otters are super busy and they need to take in a lot of calories. They have to eat, does anybody remember? What percentage of their body weight do they need to eat every single day? 25%. 25% of their body weight every single day. And they love these sea urchins. It gives them a lot of fuel, gives them a lot of calories, gives them a lot of energy to go about their busy, busy days. So this is also what's known as a keystone species. This sea otter is a very important animal for this ecosystem. They help to balance out the ecosystem because again, when we have sea urchins in abundance, they can mow down an entire kelp forest, in turn affecting all the animals that rely on that kelp forest. But when we have the sea otter in the equation, when we have the sea otter in the ecosystem, they're helping to balance out that ecosystem. Does anybody remember how many hours a day sea otters have to groom? If you said 2 to 4, you're right. And you can see the sea otter here is taking their little paws and moving their fur around because these sea otters have to groom a lot. Again, 2 to 4 hours. And it's because they have such a thick fur coat. They are actually the furriest animals in the entire animal kingdom. So if everybody can really quickly look at the back of their hand and just draw out 1 square inch. 1 square inch. It's about the size of a postage stamp. 1 square inch. And I want you to think and maybe discuss with the people around you, how many hairs are on 1 square inch of a sea otter's body? How many hairs do you think are on 1 square inch of a sea otter's body? Maybe you're thinking 100, maybe you're thinking 5,000, maybe you're thinking 100,000. All right, are you guys ready for the answer? Remember, these are the furriest creatures in the entire animal kingdom. They have 1 million hairs on 1 square inch of their body. 1 square inch, imagine their whole body, how much fur they actually have. So they've got so much fur, and again, this is a sea otter's adaptation in order to survive in the chilly ocean water. So these sea otters need to have that much fur in order to survive because unlike their marine mammal friends, they don't have blubber. So a lot of sea otters that you might be familiar with, or I'm sorry, a lot of marine mammals that you might be familiar with, like whales or maybe sea lions, they all have blubber, which is that thick layer of fat right underneath their skin. It kind of serves as insulation, right? Almost like the big jacket I'm wearing right now. It helps to keep them warm. But these sea otters, unfortunately, do not have blubber. So they have had to adapt to have something else in order to survive. They have a thick fur coat. Again, 1 million hairs per square inch, a lot of hair. So what's really cool about MPAs is that we're not just protecting the sea otter. We're not just protecting the pelicans or the kelp forest or the fish, but we're protecting the entire ecosystem and how these species interact with each other, helping to balance out that ecosystem. But there's one thing that marine protected areas cannot protect the ocean from. Does anybody know what that is? What can marine protected areas not protect the ocean from? If you said pollution or trash or plastic, you're right. Unfortunately, we don't have these borders around our MPAs, but there's no walls or nets or boundaries of any kind. It's all open water, which is great, which allows all these animals to flow in and out of these protected areas. But unfortunately, MPAs do not protect the ocean from trash and pollution. Now think about it for a moment. Do you think that there is trash and pollution in our oceans? Yeah, fortunately there is. And oftentimes it happens unintentionally. So I'm gonna go ahead and share another image with you. And give me a thumbs up if you've seen this before. Sorry, give me one moment. Give me a thumbs up if you've seen something like this before. An overflowing trash can. How many of us have seen this before? I definitely have seen an overflowing trash can before. And this is what we're meant to do, right? We're supposed to throw away our trash. We throw away our trash in the trash can, just like we're told. But there's a lot of us, right? There's a lot of us on this planet. And unfortunately, we're creating a lot of trash, a lot of waste that oftentimes ends up in our ocean because the ocean is downhill from everywhere. If you think about on your school campus or in your neighborhoods, your communities, anything that's on the ground ends up downhill. You think about wind coming by or maybe rain, it's gonna end up in a storm drain, like what we've got right here, a storm drain or a waterway, maybe a creek or a river, and it's gonna end up downhill in the ocean. So the first step in helping to reduce how much trash ends up in the ocean is simply by being mindful. And by doing that, we just pay attention to what's around us. We pay attention to the materials that we have around us. So I have a little exercise for you guys. I'm gonna play a song for about 2 minutes. And while that song is playing, I want you to look around maybe your desk, maybe the room that you're in, maybe even the clothing and everything that you've got on your body. And I want you to find 3 items made of plastic. Give me a thumbs up when you're ready. I'm gonna play a song for about 2 minutes. You get bonus points if you're dancing. And while the song is playing, I want you to find 3 items made of plastic.
It's a magic number. Yes, it is. It's a magic number. Because 2 times 3 is
6.
3 times 6 is
18.
And the 18th letter in the alphabet is
R.
Yeah. We got 3 R's we're gonna talk about today. We gotta learn to reduce, reuse, recycle. Reduce, reuse, recycle. Reduce, reuse, recycle. Well, if you go into the market. pocket to buy some juice. You gotta bring your own bags and you learn to reduce your waste. We gotta learn to reduce. And if your brother or your sister's got some cool clothes, you can try them on before you buy some more of those. Reuse. We gotta learn to reuse. And if the first two R's don't work out, and if you gotta make some trash, well, don't throw it out. Recycle. We gotta learn to recycle. We gotta learn to reduce, reuse, recycle. Reduce, reuse, recycle. Reduce, reuse, recycle. Reduce, reuse, recycle. Because three, it's a magic number. Yes, it is. It's a magic number.
All right, give me a thumbs up if you were dancing. Hopefully, oh, there's some thumbs. That's good to hear. All right, who found three plastic items? You've probably already shared with the people around you, but go ahead and discuss the items that you found. Maybe you found something big. Maybe you found something small. Maybe you found something you've had for a really long time and used it over and over and over again. Maybe you have something that you just bought and you probably won't use very long because it might not last very long. So just being mindful of the different materials that we have around us can be a really big help. So for example, I'm watching you guys on an iPad, on a tablet, and the case that it comes in is plastic. And then I have the tablet being held up by a tripod, and that tripod is made of both metal and plastic. So there's different materials on it. And even my clothing, if you look at your clothing and you see what it's made of, if you see the word polyester is plastic. So we have plastic all around us. And this little exercise might have given you some insight of the different materials that we have around us and how often we use it. And if you think about it, plastic is really not all that bad. Plastic is used a lot to help people. If you think about the medical community, doctors and nurses, they use it all the time. It helps to save lives. It helps to keep people healthy. So it can be really, really important for us. But there's a lot of plastic out there where we could probably swap it out and use something different and make a really big difference for the animals in the ocean. Because the animals in the ocean, do you think they know what plastic is? Think about that. Do you think the animals in the ocean know what plastic is? Yeah, they have no idea. They have no idea because plastic hasn't been around that long. It's only been around for maybe 100 years or so. And it was actually created by humans. So animals in the ocean or on land, they both have no idea what plastic is. Sometimes they accidentally eat it, thinking it's food. Sometimes they accidentally nestle themselves in it, thinking it's some sort of nesting material or shelter, and they can get entangled. And so these animals, they have no idea what plastic is, but that's where we come in and we can be the superheroes. We can make a big difference by helping out these animals because they don't know any better, but we do. And the first step is just by being mindful of the materials around us. So I have a little infographic here of the life cycle of some of the plastic you might be familiar with. Maybe you even found some today in this little exercise. So we're gonna look at this really briefly, but a plastic bag takes 20 years. 20 years to break up. A plastic straw takes 200 years. A plastic water bottle takes 450 years. Now take a look at that plastic toothbrush. That plastic toothbrush takes 500 years to break up. 500 years. Our great, 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 great grandchildren will probably still see this toothbrush, because it's gonna way outlive us. And it's gonna way outlive how long you're actually using that plastic toothbrush, right? Maybe use it for 6 months or 2 years, but it's gonna last 500 years afterwards. That's a really long time for something to last. So simply by paying attention to the materials around us and finding alternatives, finding something that will be healthier for our planet and healthier for the animals that live on our planet, can make a really big difference. Here are some examples here. instead of a plastic bag, maybe we use a reusable tote. And that can be made of really any material, just as long as you're reusing it over and over again. Same thing with utensils or straws, swapping out those plastics and using something like metal or bamboo or paper. And also food containers too. Ziploc bags is a big one, but maybe getting bags that you don't have to throw away right away. Maybe we have a Tupperware container or maybe one of those reusable baggies. So again, just being mindful of the different materials around us and finding alternatives can make a really big difference. And just like in the song, we have our three R's, right? Reduce, reuse, recycle. And those are all great. Think about if you go to the market and you're getting a jar of peanut butter and you're thinking about reducing and you want to reduce how much plastic you use. Maybe you pick a glass jar of peanut butter instead. And maybe you're thinking about reusing instead. So instead of that glass jar, maybe you do get that plastic container. But instead of throwing it away or maybe even recycling it, you can reuse it. You can clean it out, maybe poke some holes at the bottom, throw some dirt in and a seed, and you start a little garden. Maybe you store your pencils in there or your lunch or maybe some toys. You can reuse that container and turn it into something else. And then we also have recycle, which is a great option, but definitely not the best because unfortunately, a lot of materials can't be recycled. Plastic straws, for example, can't be recycled. Ziploc bags, unfortunately, can't be recycled. So there's actually a new fourth R, and I'm wondering if anybody knows what it is. What is that new fourth R? If you said refuse, you're right. Refuse. And what that means is to kindly refuse single-use plastics. So maybe you're going to the store or the shop with your friends or family and you're going to get a smoothie. Someone offers you a plastic straw. You can kindly say no, thank you. And not only are you reducing how much plastic you're using, but you're also inspiring others to think differently about the items that we use all the time. So inspiring others can be a really big action. And you probably all are doing a lot of these items. Maybe you're doing them on your school campuses. Maybe you're doing them at home with friends or family. And these are great ways to be planet protectors. This is a great way to protect the ocean and a great way to protect the earth overall. Now we talked a lot about ways that we can protect the ocean and the planet overall. But there's a lot of things that the ocean actually does for us. And the ocean's actually doing it right now. We're all doing this right now. Does anybody have an idea what that might be? Discuss it with the people next to you. What do you think the ocean is doing for us right now? I'll give you a hint. Breathing. Yeah, the ocean actually provides a lot of the air that we breathe. Even if I were to live 500 miles away from the ocean, I would still be benefiting from the air that the ocean provides. Did you know that every 2 breaths that humans take, one of them comes from the ocean? That's pretty miraculous. So I have one last exercise with you guys. We're gonna take 2 big breaths and thank the ocean for one. Give me a thumbs up if you're ready. We're going to take 2 big breaths and thank the ocean for one. All right, you guys ready? Go ahead and if you're seated, just sit up nice and tall. If you're standing, go ahead and stand up nice and tall. Bring your shoulders back. Hold your head up high and proud. Now deep inhale. And exhale. Inhale. And exhale. And now say thank you, ocean. Thank you so much, everyone, for tuning in today. I want to invite you to come to Morro Bay State Park. And if you're here, make sure to find me and I'll show you around. And I want to thank you all so much for being excellent ocean and earth protectors. Give yourselves a pat on the back. Keep up the great work. Just by being mindful, we can have these small steps to make a really big difference. Thank you, and have a beautiful World Ocean Week.